This video covers the idea of a Cislunar supply hub concept. The idea is to establish a space harbour as a central hub for cargo and fuel, supporting lunar and deep space exploration missions. For details on the plan, check out the DARPA Field Guide for the Lunar Economy, Chapter 13. It's linked in the video description. The study was funded by DARPA, a US government agency that funds advanced research in many different areas, and carried out by Firefly Aerospace. The lifeblood of an economy is logistics. Sequencing the movement of goods, consumables, equipment, and supplies takes careful management. A harbour in cislunar space acts as a node between Earth and the Moon. Think of it as a deep sea port for in-space logistics. By linking multiple logistic nodes together, a transport network in space can be established. Separating each leg of the journey allows for optimization in terms of volume, rate, and means of transport. Take the example of Earth-based transport networks, such as marine shipping, ground freight, and passenger air travel. All make use of nodes, legs, ports, airports, and warehouse distribution centers. All of these transport networks support intermodal cargo, e.g. ships arrive at port, and the cargo is loaded onto rail or road transport. Cargo vessels use standardized shipping containers that can be unloaded from ships and loaded directly onto road vehicles or stacked at ports. To date, space doesn't have any kind of transport network, intermodal capability, or reusable transport vehicles. Spacecraft are largely disposable and need custom payload integration. At scale, this system is complex, expensive, and limited due to the non-reoccurring engineering required. Luckily, commercial space is evolving towards reusability. At first in launch vehicles, but eventually for in-space operation. We already see efforts to introduce propellant stations, space tugs, and in-space servicing and refueling spacecraft. It's now worth thinking about developing an in-space logistics transport network to service cislunar space operations to the Moon and beyond. That's exactly what the Firefly report does. So now, let's explore their idea of an orbital harbour. An orbital harbour is the space equivalent of a marine harbour. It decouples inbound and outbound trips, allowing the rate and timing to vary. Large volume inbound traffic, say from Starship or New Glenn vehicles, could be split and redistributed to smaller volume outbound destinations, such as lunar orbit or the surface of the Moon. With progress in autonomous docking, it's now possible to develop a harbour that efficiently handles space traffic arriving from different locations. Firefly suggests a good place to start would be with upper rocket stages bound for the Moon. Today, once an upper stage has delivered its cargo to translunar injection, it's normally passivated, which ends its mission. Instead, with the existence of a cislunar hub, the upper stage can end its mission there, docking at the hub where it can be refueled, ready for its next mission. Alternatively, the upper stage after docking can merge its resources such as communications, solar arrays, edge computing into the space harbour, slowly building up the power and compute of the hub and making it available as a shared resource. From the graphic, we can see a vision for the logistics hub in cislunar space. Firefly suggests that Earth-Moon Lagrange Point 1 is the ideal location for a space harbour, as it's considered high ground. By that they mean, in terms of delta V, it has low transport costs compared to other locations. In the near term, an orbital hub in geosynchronous orbit makes sense. That's because there's credible missions in that orbit already, such as servicing or refueling high-value assets, such as GPS or telecommunication satellites. Essentially, the cislunar hub acts as a spacecraft assembly, refueling and maintenance, communications, power and computing resource. It supports and enhances the orbital lunar economy by providing storage and transport services to and from the Moon. Initially, these hubs would be autonomous, catering to launch and space vehicles. In time, habitation modules could be added, similar to roadside motels or cafes at gas stations. These hubs, by aggregating cargo and fuel, could act as staging posts to support the settlement of the solar system. Let's now talk about a vehicle designed to service these hubs. The Unit Spacecraft. The Unit Spacecraft provides essential harbour services, all built to the same design. We'll call these craft the Unit Spacecraft for the rest of this video. All of the types of craft docking at the port are considered customer spacecraft. To help with analysis, Firefly uses their own space tug, called the Electra, as the basis of the Cislunar Hub design. For a simple and practical initial design, Firefly uses four Electra spacecraft combined to form an orbital hub. Cargo and bulk cargo consists of physical goods and also propellant. Cargo transfer includes fluid transfers of propellant or liquids. The critical functions of the orbital hub that Firefly have identified are: 1. Androgynous docking allows any two spacecraft to dock and reconfigure. Robotic arms and connections allows the remote transfer of goods and assisted docking. Intermodal containers allow transferable cargo between platforms. Orbital refueling enables life extension missions for satellites and topping up of space tugs. Autonomous decisions allow safety critical management in real time without latency delays. Distributed ledgers allow record keeping for secure transactions. Networked operations allow collective cooperation for resource sharing. And modular power allows aggregation of power such as solar arrays. Now, let's look at a service the Orbital Hub can offer. Propellant as a service, Unit Spacecraft Refueling. Spacecraft or space tugs can dock and refuel, allowing much easier movement around cislunar space than is possible at the moment. This service is not only for customer spacecraft, but also for the unit spacecraft. The hub would store chemical propellants such as hypergolic fuels, which Firefly considers essential due to their widespread use. Any unit spacecraft at the hub could be deployed to other spacecraft to provide orbit-changing services, deal with space debris, or provide life extension or end-of-life services to satellites. From the graphic, we can see the refueling concept for the unit spacecraft is a cartridge-delivered blow-down system. This diagram is for the Electra space tug from Firefly, but it should work for any stirrable liquid propellant. Firefly considers cryogenic propellants not reliable for indefinite storage. But with Blue Origin's progress with cryogenic storage in space, that's a highly questionable assumption. In fact, zero boil-off technology for cryogenic propellants is essential if we're going to break out of Earth's orbit and expand humanity throughout the solar system. In this graphic, we can see the proposal for delivery of 100 metric tons of propellant via Starship vehicle. Firefly suggests a hexagonal tiling of unit spacecraft, as this helps reduce interfaces and reduces complexity and hazards. Hexagonal spacecraft have six radial interfaces for docking and fluid transfer. In the example shown, 3,000 litres of propellant and 1,000 litres of pressurant could be transferred using a single Starship vehicle. Looking at the Earth-Moon Lagrange 1 node, the preferred location for a space harbour, Firefly notes low station keeping penalties. In the case of empty propellant cartridges, Firefly suggests sending them on a lunar impact trajectory. In a previous video about reclaiming aluminium from spent upper stages in orbit and sending it to the moon, I suggested Poincaré Basin as an ideal location. This same location could be used to send spent propellant cartridges, allowing the reclaiming of metals and other materials to help build lunar bases and infrastructure. Interfaces for combining unit spacecraft together. Various space companies are working on interfaces to enable in-space servicing. Firefly uses an example from Voyager Space, the prime contractor for the Starlab space station, on how to connect spacecraft together. Their system is called Datum, or Docking, Anchoring, and Towing Universal Match Plate. The Datum plate has androgynous features for docking, fluid interlinks, and dual-mode electro-permanent magnets, or EPMs. An EPM system allows polarity reversal, simplifying docking and undocking. Two spacecraft can be soft-docked magnetically prior to initiating mechanical latching. EPMs retain the polarity in the absence of power, so would not cause undocking in the case of a temporary loss of power. Voyager Space has another product called MagTag that has the EPM technology without docking and fluid interfaces. Growth of the Cislunar Hub. Firefly explored various configurations of the hub, including square, pentagonal, hexagonal, and octagonal tiling. They found the hexagonal tiling design to have several advantages, although this is an area where more research is needed. Firefly suggests the use of zoning rules to help with hazard management. These rules control the internal organization of the orbital hub. The orbital hub would need to contend with the space environment, such as thermal temperature swings, solar power, orbital traffic, orbital debris, solar wind and radiation. An orbital hub at Earth-Moon Lagrange 1 would not benefit from the Earth's magnetic shield, exposing it to constant galactic cosmic radiation and the occasional solar flare. Stationing water on the outer parts of the hub would help mitigate radiation risks. Final thoughts. Firefly states that an orbital hub at Earth-Moon Lagrange 1 is a feasible way to provide waypoint services to a lunar economy. It can be scaled over time, gradually growing into a major space harbour, providing cargo and propellants to outbound missions to the Moon, Mars and beyond. Although the cost to establishing an orbital hub is significant, it can provide almost immediate revenue in the form of refueling and servicing missions, which space agencies such as NASA and ESA are already contracting for. More missions such as life extension, end-of-life or servicing missions are likely, with orbital debris missions needed soon to clear away thousands of spent upper stages, which continue to accumulate in low Earth orbit over time. An orbital hub would be useful for Artemis missions, simplifying the architecture for crewed missions to the Moon. What do you think about the idea of a space harbour at Earth-Moon Lagrange 1, or in geosynchronous orbit to begin with? Do you believe it would help with refueling and servicing missions? What about storing cargo in space? Leave your thoughts and opinions in the comments section below. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this space video, consider buying me a coffee to help fund more episodes like this. The link is in the description. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. The live stream is a great way for you to share your thoughts and opinions on the videos I posted this week, or on any space topic in general. I highlight the most thought-provoking comments on videos I've received, along with previews of upcoming content. If you got the time, please tune in and say hi. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.